sweat technique. Hi friends, let's talk about the brain. Okay, the brain has four quadrants, like four parts, divided kind of into hemispheres. Western, Eastern, North, South. Our body, kind of the same. Okay, we have a left side, a right side, we got our limbs going, we got the front of us and the back of us. So when we think about the brain, think about those parts. But when you begin to move, okay, whether you're tying your shoes, or you're shooting hoops, jumping rope, doing a cartwheel, playing the guitar, okay? Any type of movement of any sort starts to connect the different parts of the brain. It's how we organize thoughts and how we just keep energizing the brain. It needs to move. You ever felt really lazy on the couch and you weren't doing anything at all, and then all of a sudden you started doing something and you just kind of had more energy? It's the same way with the brain. The brain, the body, connected. I don't want you to forget that.
For over 24 years, I've worked thousands of hours of practice, perfecting every detail, nothing overlooked, from foot movement, hand placement, body angle, every detail scrutinized, constantly ready for change. All the work, all the years, all for this. One rope, one wheel, one word. This is fused.
So the brain, okay, it's about this size, and it weighs about 3 pounds. But it's processing over 100 trillion instructions per second. Now, that seems a little overwhelming or over-exaggerated. Think about how many involuntary things are going on. You don't have to think about your heartbeat, or your lungs, or anything else that's going on, even blinking. It just happens for you. Those are all those 100 trillion things and everything else that's going on in your body. But the things that we can think about, like what we eat and how active we are, okay, those are the things we can control. And those are the things that are really important. The brain is energized in two different ways. By what we eat, there's glucose in it, and that's what we need. And then in the exercise portion of it, okay, that's getting oxygen to the blood. So oxygenated blood and glucose. Now, all these things, exercise and food, it's good for your muscles, it's good for your heart, it's good for your lungs, it's good for your bones, but more than anything else, the thing that needs it the most, your noggin.
Let's be honest, not everybody could be a Michael Jordan if we tried, not everybody can be a Tiger Woods, not everybody can be an Emily Bonnell.
Here we go. Emily, a sophomore at Warren High School, won the gold medal at the rope skipping World Championships in Talbajira, Australia. This is cool because this is the 50th anniversary edition of Sports Illustrated, and I'm in here with Michael Jordan, so it makes me feel pretty good.
People have no clue really what we do. They just picture a child standing there jumping rope.
You have to be a little bit different to be in the sports after a
really say anything, they just go by and look at you like you're weird.
Jump rope isn't a sissy sport.
We're a baby.
baby compared to the big scheme of other sports. We're small.
It grows and grows and becomes infectious, like rock and roll started off small and look at how it's changed society.
Championship was started by community relations detective Dave Walker.
Very popular because the cost is low. All you have to have is a little bit of space and a double strand of rope.
Every single year, the bar is raised and the competition is harder.
The speed scores get higher. Every year, the freestyle routines are taken up a notch.
On rope skipping these days, a man responsible for the whole thing, Richard Sandali.
They went from schoolyard kids jumping rope in their local gyms, and nationals was thrown in, and the stakes got really, really high.
You are competing to be first in the nation.
This event has flown by once again. It seems like they just keep getting better every year, and the bar just keeps on getting raised.
You have the ones who play it safe, and oh, just go for it.
Children start off tripping, and they just turn into swans.
I'm just this little girl who, without hard work, wouldn't be where I am today. And I know there's a lot of people that probably won't beat me right now, but of course, my job is to beat myself. I'm my greatest competitor right now.
Tori started out very young in jumping, and she went to her first tournament, and she actually, I think, came in last place. And she came home and she said, never again. Never again will I be in last place.
Just keep working. That's a master's level.
There should be like a level higher than master's that should be in.
You guys are raising the bar when you try those kind of tricks. That's what it's all about, raising the bar.
Hi, so did you know that we can grow new brain cells? Now, it doesn't make us any smarter, but it does grow the capacity within our brain to put more stuff in. Think like a memory stick, okay? Get a little flash drive and you put it in your computer. It could be like 4 gigs. It's not a lot, okay? Or you can get one that has like 32 gigs or 64 gigs or go a little bit bigger, and we have, you know, external drives now that have like 1 terabyte. It's ridiculous amount of space, but it's in a very small container. Our brain, 3 pounds, 2 fists, a very small container, but we can open it up to be able to put more stuff in. So there's this thing, it's called embodied cognition, and psychologists have come up with this term, embodied, body, cognition, brain. It's how the brain and the body are connected in learning. And so what this embodied cognition idea is all about is that you've got to engage the body. Okay, whether you're doing something like this, okay, or all those other things we mentioned earlier, and it gets the brain engaged. Think about how often when you're procrastinating with a test, you'll watch TV, play on the computer, text nonsense to somebody, eat junk food, when really people are telling us who study the brain, who are a lot smarter than me, are saying, hey, actually eat something good, get glucose in the brain, and actually go move. Go exercise, go sweat, do something fun and you're interested in, and then your brain will actually be more ready to do the things you probably don't want to do.
So how come you don't teach anymore?
I told you I do teach. I administer classes online. Let's keep going. Effervescent.
E-F-F-E-R-V-E. S-E-N-T. Effervescent.
Come on. You know this word.
That dog's distracting me.
You're going to have much bigger distractions when you get to the National B in D.C. Now, what is that you're doing with your hand, huh?
What?
With your hand. You tap like that. What is that?
I don't know.
So why do you got all these toys for?
They belong to my niece.
Oh. So you got any kids of your own?
You ask a lot of questions, don't you?
I'm naturally inquisitive.
Yes, which is also sometimes confused with being naturally obnoxious here. Let me see you jump rope.
Just jump?
Yes, just jump.
Is there a point to this?
Yes, there is. Keep going. I said keep going. Concentrate. Stay focused. Spell effervescent. Don't think about anything else. Come on. Go.
E-F-F-E-R-V-E-S-C-E-N-T. Effervescent.
You see that? That's your trick. That's your mnemonic device.
Jumping rope?
Keeping time. You see kids at the B, they do all kinds of things. They sway back and forth, they turn around in circles. Anything they have to do to stay focused. You keep time, and I bet you if you learned the words while you kept time, you would remember them even better.
So think of it this way. What makes us move also makes us think. So every movement that we do, whether it's throwing some baseball, maybe shooting some hoops, riding a bike, jumping some rope, which is what our class is about to get into, we're going to test these theories of the brain with our social studies. We got to learn something? Well, let's do it while we're moving.